Testing, check, check, check. And are we rolling? Wait. All right. That's better. Today we're in Analog at the Hutton Hotel in Nashville, Tennessee. And joining us is the wonderful Natalie Hemby.
Hey, Joe, how are you?
Good, how are you?
I'm so happy to be here, and I love this room so much. I've performed in this room, so I'm glad to be your guest today.
Oh, well, we're so glad to have you, and to be talking about all the new music that you're making, which is just fantastic. You've got a new record, Pins and Needles. It is a really, really fantastic record. I love just the way that you combine different sounds and styles, but then your really definitive voice as a songwriter comes across. It's really enjoyable to listen to.
Thank you so much. That means the world coming from you.
I want to start with getting a little bit of just context and kind of talking about the major event that's kind of shaping the world right now, which is the pandemic.
Yes.
When did it start for you? And what was your pandemic experience like?
I was at the Grammys that year. I won my first Grammy that year. So it was an amazing start to the year in the High Women. We were gonna maybe do some shows and that sort of thing. And the pandemic happened, everything got shut down. You know, I wasn't sure how this was all gonna play out, but I was talking to Fantasy Records at the time. They really liked some of the songs on my record. I had not finished my record yet. So my husband and I, we just decided to finish the record. And I ended up getting a record deal during the pandemic, which is so strange. Never mind the, in my early 20s, I wanted a record deal all those years, you know, but for some reason, my time was during a pandemic at 43 years old. That's when I got my record deal, but I'm so grateful for it.
Did that kind of like totally change your perspective on your artistry and kind of give you like a newfound vigor?
I had so many doors shut when I was younger, when it came to my artistry and when I was trying to get a deal, that I just wanted to know if they were genuinely in. And I really cared about my project, but I just didn't know what that was going to look like, because we didn't know what was happening. You know, everything was shut down. We didn't know when people were going to start touring again. But it did allow me, though. My husband allowed my husband to fine tune everything, and you know, we mastered the record and it turned out exactly the way we wanted it, which I could not be more proud of.
I want to ask about your time with the High Women, because obviously we love the High Women, such a great group.
Oh, yeah.
And you had already had a solo record out at that point, but I gotta imagine that doing that experience must have been just like a whole new level of kind of like learning, or even just being able to kind of do that with those artists. What was it like kind of approaching this record having had that under your belt?
I wouldn't say it affected the process of making my record, but what it did do was open my eyes to live shows. I didn't know anything about set design. I didn't know anything about branding or just pyrotechnic dancers. I'm just joking, obviously. But I didn't know about anything about live show or touring. That's a whole different world than songwriting and making records. And these three tour all the time, and they're on the road. They have it down. And I just literally got thrown into the mix of everything. And next thing I know, we're singing with Dolly Parton, we're playing Jimmy Fallon, and I just enjoyed it. You know, I just took it all in. It was overwhelming. And also, those three girls are superstars, you know. They really are in their own right. We are four completely different women, and we each bring something to the group, but I was pretty in awe of how well they handle all this.
Well, I want to ask about writing on this record. And specifically, I'm curious, kind of, obviously, you're a really, really talented songwriter who's written some of, like, the best songs ever in country music for other artists and stuff. What's it like approaching, like, something for yourself where you're going to be the one singing?
I always brought something of myself into a writing room, you know, and whether or not an artist chooses to go with that song, if they like it or not, it's up to them. But these songs have come over years and years of writing. And the lucky thing for me is that I just have an enormous vault of songs that nobody has cut that I really still love, and probably have like five or six albums worth in there. But the fun part was just being able to pick them out. One example is Pins and Needles itself. I wrote that. That was the first song I ever wrote with the Brothers Osborne, and we wrote that over a decade ago. And they were going to put it on their record, but it just didn't fit what they were doing. And so I just basically was like, hey, I still love this song. I was like, do you mind if I just take this and put it in my pocket? And they were like, absolutely. And a lot of those songs on the record have been that way. Probably the newer ones have been Pinwheel was probably the newest one that I wrote on there. But the rest of them are anywhere from a decade or shorter.
So. Oh my God. Yeah, well, at that point then, what's it kind of feel like to be able to like go back to a song that's like 10 years old and be like, oh, this is still just has like the same urgency it had when I wrote it?
A good song is timeless, you know? It doesn't matter what era it falls under or what kind of production it has. If it's a great song, it will stand the test of time. I just wanted to bring it back and basically let this be a record that I never really got to make.
I know that your husband, Mike Rucki, produced it all.
Yes.
What was it kind of like, or like approaching like how you were gonna incorporate different styles?
My husband, he plays everything. He played pretty much almost everything on my record. We brought in Dan Needham on drums on a couple of songs. He plays on Heroes and Pins and Needles. And we also had Chuck Lavelle play on It Takes One. And Greg Lease is a longtime friend of ours. He played pedal steel on a couple of songs. But Mike usually plays best stuff, and we are from the same era of music. So he's only 5 years older than me. So we pretty much already have that dialed in. Like, we just love, we gravitate towards that style of music. So when you say ethereal, yes. I like loved Sarah McLachlan, Fumbling Towards Ecstasy. And then when you say roots rock, like I had all of Tom Petty's records, just like most people in Americana music do. It's almost a staple in the house. But it also, I grew up listening to Bonnie Raitt, and I grew up listening to Sheryl Crow. And it was just like, if you put all those factors in there, you have Natalie Himby baby. So that's kind of what came out of it, so.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, I want to ask about a few specific songs, if that's all right.
Yes.
And the first one I want to ask about is Heroes, which is a really kind of cool, like, angle to a song. I don't want to meet my heroes. I just want to be a face in the crowd.
Yeah.
When did you write this? What kind of inspired it?
It's been about 5 years ago, maybe six. Basically, there is somebody that, you know, everyone's always asking me, who have you written with that's been your heroes? And I've got to work with a lot of them. And I will say I do love them, but there is one particular person that I have never gotten to work with, and I literally own all their records, and I have heard over the years just what a terrible person this person was. So I was like, you know what, I don't ever want to meet them, because it'll change the way I feel about their music in some ways. I just want to keep it up there. I don't want to be that way. I don't want to ever discourage somebody from their dream, that sort of thing.
I want to ask about Radio Silence as well. This is an awesome song, and I really loved kind of the story that was in the press material that talked about how, you know, it's a song about a friend who's kind of like shutting down or maybe not letting you help them as much as maybe you'd want to help them. And I loved that it kind of said that when you were writing it, you kind of saw yourself as the friend in the song.
Friend. Yeah.
What's it kind of like writing a song from that perspective?
You know, it's very humbling, and you kind of hate it because it's like therapy in a way. I'm so used to helping other people shine light on their world. I've kept mine in the dark for a while, and you know, sometimes there's pieces of you that, you know, you're not so proud of that you don't really want to put to light, but you know, it's been, I've probably gotten so many letters from that song alone.
I'm curious how you feel now.
It feels amazing, and there's this part of me that's like, I hope people like my record, but then I'm also like, I like my record, so I'm okay with it, whatever happens. I think that's the most important thing. You just have to make the music that you love. I just try to be as sincere as possible with whatever I put out. And I'm looking forward, honestly, to making more, you know? But I really do hope people love this record, because I'm really proud of it. And it was made over time, and to me, you can tell that.
Well, that's awesome. Well, it's been such a joy speaking with you today.
Thank you, buddy. It's such a joy speaking to you, and I appreciate you having me on your show.
Yeah, absolutely. Natalie Hemby's new record, Pins and Needles, is out. For American Songwriter, I'm Joe Vito. Thanks for tuning in.